letter from Dr. Remick. Dear Quest faculty.
I am calling a meeting for 12 o'clock noon to discuss the Quest program for next year.
It is extremely important that you all attend. Signed, the President.
Gentlemen, I have called you here to inform you that the incoming Quest students for next year are all top scholars. It is my full responsibility to make sure that they receive the best education possible. As president of this institution, I am taking steps to make sure you are thoroughly prepared. Therefore, I am sending you all back in time to the periods, which you will have to know the best.
I hope I get to go to the Augustan period.
I sure hope they send Pat along. He's probably still in bed.
Dangerous. It has just been developed by our astrophysics department. Now, men, I'm counting on you. Good luck in your quests. And for the sake of next year's students, I hope this time travel doesn't kill you. Later, dudes.
Hey, Sue, take a look at this. Dear Dr. Sprout, by now I have sent your Quest colleagues back to various times in history. I have chosen you to hold down the fort here at Westminster and finish out this semester of Quest. Signed, the President. Wow, what an honor. He must think I really know my material.
Oh, you do, Dr. Sproul.
It appears that we are in ancient Greece. What a fine display of Doric architecture. Pat?
No,
Pat?
No, the quizzes aren't ready yet.
Oh, wake up, Pat. We're not in class anymore. It appears that we are in ancient Greece.
Plato, your ideas are so stupid.
Why do you always have to cut me down all the time? You always think you're right.
No one ever agrees with any of your ideas. It's because they're so stupid.
Stupid? You'll see. Someday I'll be famous.
Gentlemen, what appears to be the problem here?
No, I'm sorry. Quiz isn't ready.
Well?
I was just telling Diogenes about these things called ideas. You see, true reality can only be recognized by our souls. All physical things are only a shadowy reflection of these invisible ideas.
Did you hear that? What a ridiculous idea.
You just let me finish one second. As I was saying, our souls are immortal and they can be reincarnated.
Well, I bet you think you're a reincarnated plucked chicken, you dummy.
Oh, yeah? I bet you think you're a reincarnated dog, dork.
That guy's such a cynic.
I like the sound of that.
Gentlemen, if you would permit me to explain some things. First of all, would you like some cinnamon toast crunch?
Ramen. What?
Ramen. That hasn't been invented for a couple thousand years.
It's not going to be invented for a couple thousand years?
No.
I'm saving it. It's mine.
See? Deep down, people really are selfish.
Oh, yeah? Well, you should take a look at yourself and make a change.
I think I hear a song coming on.
They follow the pattern of the wind.
Make the world a better place. Take a look at yourself, then make a change. I'll start dealing with the
is going to be a review overall of what we have learned. Before we start, Sue has some papers to pass out to all of you. There are the remainder of the syllabus, as well as some quizzes and back papers that she has to hand out. So, as we begin. What the hell is Quest, anyways? And what have we learned? Well, we must start at the beginning, obviously, and that would be with the creation of the Earth. This, of course, is China. Now, there are many reasons that China is on the world, and one of them is because they are so smart. They have given us many, many things, and we will see that throughout Quest. First of all, the creation of the world is seen in many different religions as just marvelous exploitation of land mass here. Because first, there's much land over here, and then the oceans, everything, it's gone, and there's not as much. Which brings us to Greece, little tiny piece here. Greece is what they had. They had many gods, is what they had, and man was not the only creature known to be a featherless biped, as shown by Diogenes. There was the plucked chicken, of course. Now, in the medieval period, you know, they did come up with a lot of pottery, a lot of nice pots, and we come to the Middle Ages with... Anyone? Prunting, Beowulf sword. And that's the name of the sword. And from the medieval period, there is feudalism. Kings, the courts, and the knights. Now then there's the serfs. The serfs are not even on the triangle. The serfs are way below the triangle. They have a dismal life. They lived to about 25, and they're dead, and the moles, the maggots just eat their eyes out and everything. It's a pretty bad life, if you ask me. They have dirt. That's all they own, is dirt. They own dirt. They have, like, no shoes, no nothing. I don't even know why these people existed. It's pretty pointless to me. I would rather have been a king. They had it up, you know, they had a good life. But the serfs, they did nothing, they didn't have anything. Though throughout the Middle Ages, in the dirt, they did have many inventions, one of which was the plow. See, the plow was one of their biggest inventions, and that helped with the dirt. And the serfs, of course, had dirt as well, the serfs. Philosophies. Plato, Aristotle, they all had philosophies, but their founders came from China, of course, and Diogenes even said that China was a much better country to live in because they had... Well, it's 859, so just a few more points before Roman lectures today. Tomorrow we're going to be lecturing about something else that's incomprehensible and not worth mentioning, but basically, you know, there'll be a lot of my stupid jokes and arm-waving, of course, as I interrupt everyone else, is basically how this class is going to go. So before I go, just a few more things here. We'll be discovering the literature of the periods that we have talked about today. China's literature, you know, I should mention, China also had books, because they invented paper, they did have books, and they had a lot of literature as well. So we'll be studying that tomorrow. Sue, I believe you have a couple of announcements.
Yes, there will be a study session tonight, 11 o'clock in the tub. Be sure to be there. I have a lot of information and a lot of pointers for the quiz that will be tomorrow.
Look at the combination of the Gothic Romanesque architecture. You notice it's Gothic because of the point at the top, and yet Romanesque because of the roundness. Oh, monks! Jeez. Thanks to Pope Gregory and the Gregorian chant, I have a job. You see, because of the Gregorian chant, monophonic music came about, right, Dan?
Yeah.
And later on in the Gothic period, there was polyphonic music came about, right, Dan?
Yeah.
And later on, they added instrumentals to the church music, which brings about my job as an organist at Westminster College in New Wilmington, and I am a professor of quest and music. Not that you guys sound bad or anything, but monophonic music, meaning that there is only one melody line, can tend to get boring. If you notice, you are putting your congregation to sleep. Right, Dan? I think that we should try a little bit of variety. Polyphonic music, as I stated earlier, was established in the Gothic period, and what we want to do here is try to make a variety in your service. Because you guys live fairly boring lives, I mean, wool robes and no underwear and all. You like that one, Dan?
Yeah.
Must be those steroids. What we're going to do is I want to have one of you volunteer to be the tenor, which you will sing and withhold one note while the rest of us, we are going to sing the melody. I have a volunteer. You, and your name is... Never mind, we don't have names, okay? We're going to try this. I want you to sing this note here. Can you do that? Okay, now the rest of us, would you please hold that? Now the rest of us. I don't think we've quite got the hang of that yet. All right, I think I've got something here I know you're going to like. It's by the Beach Boys. Round, round, get around.
I get around, yeah, get around, round, round, I get around, I get around. Been beat, and we never missed yet with the girls we meet.
Well, that was enough time for the quiz. Did all those pointers I gave you last night help, all of you? I hope. Okay. All right, now, Dr. Sproul, I think, will be a little late today, so I'm just going to continue with what he has prepared for today's lesson. Now, we're talking about Beowulf.
How many of you read Fables? How many of you really read Beowulf? I never read Beowulf, and I passed all my quizzes, and I got an A in class, and... Well, hello, Dr. Sproul.
Hello, sorry I'm late.
That's okay.
I trust Sue took care of the quiz and everything. This morning, what were we talking about, Sue?
Beowulf.
Okay. Who read Beowulf? Well, that's very good. I'm glad to see that everyone's keeping up with the reading. It is a tough reading, but are there any questions on Beowulf that you have, you know,
Now remember, to get your points in, we need to have 5 discussion points.
Yes.
Was there some symbolic meaning to Runting?
No, it's just a sword, basically. His name, his little nuts naming a sword. I wouldn't do that. It was kind of a dumb thing, I thought, but yeah, there's no symbolic, nothing, no. Point. Anyone else? Yes?
I disagree. I think it was very important. The sword in King Arthur, that was Excalibur. And what about the sword in Roland?
Were you on Jeopardy? I don't think so. Anyone else?
I think order has a lot to do with the sword in Beowulf, and I think it all basically gets back to order.
Well, of course it doesn't. That's the most ridiculous thing I've ever heard. What do you think, Sue?
Oh, I think it's just preposterous.
Anyone else?
Eric, did you have your hand up? You are lacking in discussion points.
Well, Beowulf was pretty cool.
Good point, Eric. It's a little general. Could you elaborate, be a little more specific on that for us? Cool.
Well, I don't know how many guys could take on, you know, like some monster and his monster's mother and then dragon. I mean, I've never fought a dragon, so... I think he's cool.
Well, of course it all goes back to the symbolism in his sword, Runting.
I thought there wasn't symbolism.
Of course there was. It's loaded with symbolism. The whole book is all about...
Mole tried to point that out, that there was symbolism with that.
No, she was saying something different. I'm sure that, no, there was symbolism in the sword. Yes.
Well, is there any order to this at all?
Well, of course. I mean, the whole book is all about order. It's with the whole the power struggle, it all reverts back to order, don't you think so?
Oh, definitely.
Does anyone else have a point that they would like for me to refute?
How did I get here? You see, I have no idea how I got here, and... you see, I just like to know where I am, okay? Okay.
And dare to enter King Hrothgar's territory.
'Tis Beowulf. He hath come to slay the mighty Grendel who hath plagued thy kingdom.
But he is a little seasick.
This is the medieval sword, Grunting. You see, this was created in the medieval ages, and this was a sword used by Beowulf to help kill some of the evil characters, you see, okay?
And who art thou, O one dressed in strange clothes?
And what dost thou do with such a sword such as that?
My name is Dr. Castro, of course. I am a teacher at Westminster College, you see, and I teach history of Roman and Greek, and you know, I always thought Beowulf was just like a fake story, you know, I just taught it and acted like I knew everything about it, you see, of course. But now that I am here and I possess the sword Grunting, I see that I must have to defeat the evil monster, you see,
Grendel?
Grendel, yes.
Hark! What is that I see off in the distance?
Tis Grendel!
That's my cue.
Ah!
a monster. First, I will take off my sweater. Where's my sword? Grunting? I'm thinking. All right, you big evil monster, let's see what you have. Okay? Okay, you big bad monster. Unguard, let's see what you have. Oh no, you see, it's time to leave.
I'm delighted to see you all made it back safely. I trust that you are all thoroughly prepared for Quest for next semester. You have made me now very, very proud. As always, our ultimate goal here at Westminster College is to help students become the best human beings they can be. To all of you who have completed your first Quest semester, congratulations. Now have a relaxing and enjoyable summer. And please never forget to ask yourself at least once a day, what does it mean to be fully human?
Lifestyles of the Middle Ages. I'm your host, Robin Leach. In today's show, we'll bring you some of the most influential figures of the day into your home. First, we'll traverse the rough Mediterranean to Northern Europe and talk to the legendary Charlemagne. Then we'll journey to the barbaric British Isles and talk with that lovely lady of Camelot, Guinevere. Finally, we'll view the mysteries of the monastic life. So stay with us for an exciting show. First, traveling to Europe from Gaul, where we'll be meeting with Charlemagne, one of the most important figures of the day. He's just been recently crowned Emperor of the West by the Pope on Christmas Day in the year of our Lord 800.
Stay tuned, because Lifestyles of the Middle Ages will return after this message.
Oh, welcome to McDonald's. May I help you?
Oh. What do you got?
Well, we have pork, tastes like
Georges and two girls. Have a nice day. Thank you.
The Grendels.
Over.
One.
Billion.
Serve.
Serve.
Of the show, Lifestyles of the Middle Ages. Are you Charlemagne, perhaps?
Oh, oui.
Great! I found the man, the myth, the legendary Charlemagne. Tell me, sir, who are you fighting out there?
We are fighting the Saxons today. We've been fighting them for 30 years.
I see. You'll win this war against the Saxons, as you say?
This war? Of course there we will. The Lord is on our side. He gave me a vision. He said, kill the bloody Saxons!
I see. You seem mighty confident of victory, Lord. Why are you so confident that you'll win? They're very dangerous. I've heard about those barbarian hordes.
Yes, oui, but the Lord is on our side, the church is on our side. We have the discipline, we have the strength, we have the sword.
Excuse me. I see what you mean.
Yes, listen.
Little entertainment, perhaps.
Right.
Okay. Next question now. What has been your greatest accomplishment thus far?
Oh, greatest accomplishment? There's been so many. Let me think.
Oh no! Oh, this one here is the king of all Western Saxons.
That's easy.
I see. No problem.
But your question? My greatest accomplishment.
Yes.
The education and the laws are my great laws I've made.
Yes, it does look pretty grisly, I'd say. So, when you die, what will happen to your kingdom? How will you divide it up? How will you?
As is the Frankish tradition, I shall divide it between my sons.
I see. Do you think your empire will last when you die?
Of course it will. It's not just my
empire. Lord Empire! Oh my gosh! Holy! Oh, well, help me! Help me, won't you? Oh my! Oh no!
What you good?
This is Robin Leach, signing off. My hand's pretty much cut off, but that's all right. Signing off from Lifestyles of the Middle Ages. See you later.
Spoken with Charlemagne, we will continue our journey, head across the channel to England to meet with the legendary King Arthur. Many say that he is purely fictitious and that his accomplishments are greatly exaggerated. We will find out in just a few minutes if he is a man or a myth.
Yeah.
You've seen the well-to-do up and down Park Avenue on that famous thoroughfare with their noses in the air. High hats and arrow collars, white spats and lots of dollars, spending every dime for a wonderful time. If you're blue and you don't know where to go to, why don't you go where fashion sits, putting on the Ritz.
Please come and shop at Saks Fifth Avenue in downtown Westminster for all your surfwear needs.